1927, I wrote a review which served two purposes, the one in to get an overview of the entire field of neuroembryology, what are the basic problems of experimental embryology applied to the development of the nervous system, which has a unique position in among all the organs. I mean, there's the development of the liver and of the heart and of the spleen, of the skeleton, of the muscles and so on. But of course, the development of the nervous system is of special interest for several reasons. One of them, of course, that the nervous system in the adult regulates all other functions. So does it do that in the embryo too? The answer is no. The nervous system, the primordium of the nervous system itself, is the product of an inductive process, and that was one of the key elements in the organizer experiment of Spemann and Hinder-Mangold, who discovered that the nervous system owes its existence to an inductive act on the part of the subjacent mesoderm. I don't have to go into any detail. At any rate, the embryonic nervous system is the product of an inductive process. And as I showed in this other experiment, that this nerveless leg, it's by no means the dominating factor in the development of other structures. The limb can very well do without ever being innervated if it loses its muscles. But the second intent of the review was to make my own results public. And I don't want to go into details, but I had some very interesting observations also in these nerveless legs on the distribution of nerves and the problem of how nerves find their way to their targets. I won't go into detail except to say that I found in quite a few cases that since the nerves on the right side were absent, there should not be any innervation. But I did find that in a number of cases, nerves from the left side transgressed the midline and entered the nerveless leg. Well, a side issue which I don't want to follow, but that interested me because I knew that the question of how nerves find their way to the targets had been acute, and the transplantation experiment of limbs, which has been largely initiated by Harrison, had served that purpose too. So that was not a new problem. But to sum it all up, I established three, well, not I established, but I recognized three major problems in neurogenesis. The one is, to what extent are non-nervous structures dependent on the nervous system? And for the limb, I had answered that in no. Second problem was the reverse. Do the target structures influence the development of the nerve centers which innervate them? Which became the major issue in my the rest of my life. And the third question was, as I mentioned, how do nerves find their way to their targets? The second question relating to the influence of the target on the head, also on the nerve centers which innervated, had been pioneered by Detweiler, who had found that if you remove the target, the spinal ganglia become smaller. If you put the target in a region where the spinal ganglia are normally small, they become larger. So he had actually discovered the relation that the targets have something to do with the growth of the subspinal ganglia, which innervate them, but he had found no reaction of the motor system. It turned out that he was wrong on that, and I don't want to go into details. And there was only one other experiment that had been done in Chicago by a student of Lilly in 1909. And this lady, Miss Shorey, at Dr. Lilly's instigation, had found that when she extirpated the leg bud of a chick embryo by electrocautery, which was at that time the only way of getting rid of things, both the sensory ganglia and the motor columns were reduced. So to anticipate something, when I came to Lilly's laboratory, we decided I should repeat the Shorey experiment. This is my first adventure into chick embryology. The professor of embryology at Chicago Zoology was one Dr. Benjamin Willier, and I was assigned to him. Lilly took me on the first date to introduce me to him, to Willier and his right hand, Dr. Rawls, who did all the experiments, showed me how to handle a chick embryo, how to incubate, how to saw a hole in the shell to look into it, and the rest was my own, left to me. So I settled down, and in a few months I had developed the technique of removing limbs or eye buds or whatever and transplanting. And to the great surprise, astonishment of the faculty and graduate students, I showed them a transplanted wing or leg, which of course looks very strange when it is in the trunk region of the body or somewhere else. And I didn't expand it to eyes or anything else. I did that later. And so the limb of the embryo, which had been given me the starting point in Freiburg, remained the object of central interest. And I found immediately that Miss Shorey was right, and Detweiler was wrong, and that at least in the chick embryo, both the sensory and the motor centers were greatly reduced when the target area was removed, which meant that, comparable to induction, but on an entirely different plane, the target has a profound influence on the nerve centers which were later innervated, which in itself is a fantastically interesting phenomenon. So I asked myself, what kind of questions does this result establish?